All right, I now understand it's time for us to go to Mission Control. They should be hearing us. Josh, are you there?
Hey, Ryan, we're here. Thanks for tossing it to us. I'm Josh Byerly here inside Mission Control of Houston. I am currently...
Now it's time for us to go to Mission Control. For the past 30 minutes, I've been talking with Ball High School in Galveston, Texas, talking about some of the amazing things that are happening here at NASA, as well as the International Space Station. We are connected to Mission Control, I understand. Josh, are you there?
Yeah, we're here, Ryan. This is Josh Byerly here inside Mission Control. We want to thank you guys for joining us here. I'm here with Mike Serafin, who is a flight director here. He is both a space station and a space shuttle flight director, worked a number of shuttle missions, also is working an upcoming test flight for our Orion spacecraft, which is the one that we're designing to go out into deep space here in the next few years. So the flight director is really in charge of the entire team here. So Mike knows quite a bit about how things work, both here on the ground and up in space. So let's go ahead and take your questions.
Hi, my name is Andrea. How many people fit in the space shuttle and space station?
Hi, that's a good question. Welcome to Mission Control. The space shuttle, we have seats for 7 people to fly up on that. And on the space station, we've got enough room to sleep 6 people. So right now we've got 6 astronauts and cosmonauts staying on board the International Space Station. And when what we call visiting vehicles, a space shuttle or another crewed spaceship like the Russian Soyuz come and visit, the space station houses those folks as well. And sometimes during the space shuttle missions that we flew in the past, the people would get up to 13 on board the space station.
Who's next?
Hi, my name is Raquel Archie, and my question is, what are the current missions of the space station?
Hi, Raquel. Well, the space station has a number of missions. All of them revolve around science and engineering and understanding the Earth and the solar system. Right now, we've got experiments on board, physics experiments like the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer that are measuring particles out there in space. It sees billions of particles a month. We are studying the human body and how that changes in a microgravity environment. One of the more compelling experiments going on right now is understanding how the fluid shift from the lower body to the upper body increases what they call intracranial pressure in the human's head, and how that affects our ability to see and changes in vision over time in space. There are also material science experiments. There's one of my favorite experiments is called MISSI. It's a materials in space experiment where we fly science materials or various spacecraft components on board a platform that sits outside the space station and expose it to the vacuum of space and the extreme heat and cold of space, and we see how those materials react. So those are just a couple of experiments. There are also medical experiments and just general fluid physics and other science experiments we conduct.
And actually, to Mike's point, some of those experiments that we have on board right now are actually designed by students. I mean, some of them flew up on the recent SpaceX mission that were designed by kids just like you, and some of them I can't even pronounce what they are, but they're very cool, and it's kind of neat to see students like you guys actually designing things that the crew is actually testing on board the space station. So it's a good question. Who's up next?
And I couldn't agree more, Josh. This is Ryan at the DLN. I'm going to cut in real quickly, if you don't mind. I'm getting word now that if the school could change the camera shot to the wide classroom shot, that would be better. And you might want to also watch your mute button. If you could mute your microphone between questions, that we'd also appreciate that.
Okay. I'll tell you what. Why don't you go ahead and stand where you were sitting and just ask the question from there.
So do we have another question?
So I think the question was, what are our current plans for future space travel? In the short term, we're going to continue to fly to the International Space Station and do the experiments that we just talked about. and develop technology required to go to deep space and send humans beyond low Earth orbit. As Josh mentioned at the outset of our talk together, I'm the lead flight director for one of the missions where we're going to fly the Orion capsule. It's going to be a man-capable spacecraft up to an altitude of 3,300 nautical miles. It'll be the highest that a man-capable spacecraft has flown since the 1970s in the Apollo era, and we're going to test out its capabilities with the intent of sending humans around the moon and back in the late 2017-2019 timeframe. So we're going to continue to explore low Earth orbit and then push out from there.
Good question. Who's next?
Hi, my name is Emily O'Bara, and in the International Space Station, can you see weather patterns like hurricanes, clouds, etc.?
Yeah, absolutely. We can see all of the Earth's weather from space. One of the primary things that the astronauts like to do in their free time is to just look out the window. We have this wonderful platform, the viewing platform called the Cupola, and it has a series of windows, and it looks down at the Earth. And they take wonderful photographs. A lot of those are posted on the NASA website, www.nasa.gov. And you can look at those on a daily basis. They update those photos every day based on what the astronauts view. One of my favorite things to do here in Mission Control is just to watch the video coming down from the International Space Station. Mm-hmm. And we've seen things like hurricanes, just missing the United States, and the smoke plumes from volcanoes erupting, or smoke plumes from forest fires in Texas and in other areas around the world. We've seen the aftermath of tsunamis on the other side of the world, and just you see some remarkable things, including land use pattern and how humans are using the Earth either for agriculture or to build ports or cities here on Earth.
Matter of fact, there's some wildfires in New Mexico and Colorado that they flew over yesterday and tried to get some pictures of. And, of course, like Mike said, just log on to the NASA website and you can see any of those pictures. Some of them have gotten just a ton of views on the website because they're so remarkable to take a look at them. So if you haven't seen it, go check it out. You can probably also spot your hometown in some of those pictures as well. Galveston's kind of easy to spot, so.
Yeah, Galveston is a real easy place to see. You just follow the Texas coastline along, and then you'll see Galveston Bay, the Trinity Bay area, and then the Galveston sitting just below it. It's pretty easy to spot on a nice clear day.
Yeah. Who's up next?
Hi, my name is Caitlin Hamilton, and what role does each country play now in regards to the International Space Station?
Okay, that's a good question. Now that we've built the International Space Station, all of the nations that are involved in the space station program are still cooperating to not only fly their own astronauts up to the International Space Station and perform their own nation's science objectives, but we're also working together to do things like do interplanetary exploration. There are missions that NASA and the United States government flies with the European Space Agency and the Japanese Space Exploration Agency. We've got a lot of joint missions that are going on together, partly because they're really expensive and we want to share the cost, but also because it's important to cooperate with other nations. You use that as a foundation to just have a good working relationship together.
It also shows the importance of learning other languages, which is going to be critical to, I think, you guys and everybody that comes behind you. I mean, most of our astronauts, if not all of them, speak some amount of Russian, and some of them speak Japanese. So it's important to be able to communicate with all of our different partners on board to learn about those different cultures and their languages as well.
Right, and one of the more unique things you learn when you get into a field like spaceflight and engineering is that math and science are a universal language in of themselves, because you don't need to translate any of that. It's the same in Russian and Japanese and English as it is any other language. So just the fact that we're cooperating and talking the same things, it goes a long way.
Math is important, unless you're a journalism major, and then it's not so much.
Well, you still got to pay your bills, right?
Yeah. So who's next?
My name is Aruna Sivianson, and my question is that last month the private space company SpaceX sent its Dragon ship to the International Space Station. Will NASA's Mir space vehicle be similar to the Dragon?
That's a good question.
That is a great question. The Orion spacecraft that we're going to fly here in 2014 is similar but very different in terms of capability from the Dragon spacecraft. NASA has consciously agreed with the commercial space industry to not compete for low Earth orbit commercial services. So to send cargo to and from the International Space Station, we're going to let our commercial partners like SpaceX and other companies handle that. But for the what we'll call the high ground above low Earth orbit and services that go outside of what the International Space Station flies to, altitudes, you know, in excess of 500 nautical miles, that is where NASA will continue to explore and push out from Earth, not only just to see what the environment is like, but also to learn about the benefits of space.
And one thing is, you got to realize that, you know, going to the station is about a two-day trip. And when we go to an asteroid or someplace like that, or even back to the moon, you're talking about weeks, if not months, of trying to get there. So what are we flying? It's got to take a lot of gas, a lot of air, a lot of water for the crew. And so Orion's a little bit different in terms of what it's got to do and the environment inside and how the crews are going to live in there. So it's a bit of a different vehicle, a lot of different requirements for it.
Yeah, probably the biggest difference there is Orion has to have a heat shield that is capable of withstanding what we call a high-velocity reentry.
Yeah.
When we come out of low Earth orbit, the speed of the spacecraft is around 25,000 miles per hour, but when we come back from the moon, it is far greater than that, and the heat shield has to be able to take all that energy out and withstand the heat of reentry, and you design the spacecraft around that. So the companies like SpaceX are designing robust heat shields, but they're only designed for low Earth orbit and reentry from there,
yeah.
Whereas the Orion spacecraft has to be a lot more robust and capable of withstanding a far greater heat.
Yeah. So who's next?
Speak up a little louder, Ashley.
What would you consider NASA's greatest accomplishment?
What was that question?
What is NASA's greatest accomplishment?
Okay.
That's a tough question. What is NASA's greatest accomplishment? Certainly flying 30 years of the space shuttle is at or near the top of the list. The Hubble Space Telescope and all of its discoveries are at the top of the list. And then the International Space Station, assembling that. The Mars missions that we've explored and put rovers and seen, fantastic photos and video of that. It's really hard to pick. It really depends on your area of interest, whether that's interplanetary exploration, seeing planets like Saturn and Jupiter, or whether it's seeing stars that are far beyond our solar system, or whether it's just observing the Earth or the human element in space. I think it really depends, but we've got a lot of great accomplishments.
Yeah.
My question is, how does the space station avoid running another spacecraft or satellites orbiting the Earth?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that question, please?
How does the space station avoid running into other satellites or spacecraft orbiting the Earth?
Something about other SAG. Can we get you guys to repeat the question one more time?
Yeah. He asked, how do you avoid running into other spacecraft
okay.
and satellites while orbiting the Earth?
Yeah, that's a great question. Certainly avoiding other spacecraft and man-made debris as well as natural debris that exists out there in space, meteoroids and micrometeoroids, is one of the key things that we do here in Mission Control. We've got a lot of information out there about where objects are and where they orbit relative to the space station. We know exactly where the space station is, and we have a pretty good idea where a lot of other debris is in space. And we use that to basically track or map where they are relative to each other. So if you've got, for example, two vehicles on a road and there's an intersection coming up, you want to know that they're going to cross that intersection at different times. So what we do here in Mission Control, working with a number of our counterparts outside of Houston is to track where those objects are relative to the space station and then make sure that they're not going to intersect at the same time. Occasionally, we do find that there's going to be a pretty close call, and what happens in those cases is we actually move the space station out of the way and we perform what's called a debris avoidance maneuver, and we literally push the space station to a higher orbit or a lower orbit and get it out of the way so that it crosses that intersection at a different time.
And keep in mind, the space station weighs about close to 1 million pounds, so that's there actually is somebody here in Mission Control that technically steers the thing, and it's called an ADCO, Attitude Determination and Control Officer, and they can work to... The U.S. has a bit of a different way of steering the station than the Russian side does, but yeah, they can just move it. It's one thing you can do in space you really can't do here on Earth. So, who's next?
Astronauts do. How do they prepare the astronauts for like motion sickness and such things?
Yeah, if we can get you guys to get a little bit closer to the phone, I think we'll be able to hear you a little bit better.
Carson, why are you trying to come around?
Hold on 1 second, guys. Sorry about that.
Wait, repeat the question again.
Go ahead.
Okay. With all the training that the astronauts do, how does the training prepare them for things like motion sickness?
Okay.
Good question again. The astronauts actually, we train them to experience what is essentially weightlessness or microgravity before they ever fly. We have an aircraft that some people call it the Weightless Wonder, where we fly people and they experience short periods of microgravity or weightlessness. And that gives you the experience of floating in space or free falling for short periods of time. So we know what that feels like. And then there's a lot of other physiological training. So performing exercise and just general strength and conditioning that people do before they fly that we know helps combat the space sickness or occurrence of space sickness. So there's things that we can do that are considered preventative measures, but then we also train people to experience what it's going to be like before they ever get there, so they know what it's like and they know how to combat that.
Good question. Who's next?
My name is Bethany. Have you always wanted to work at NASA, and what steps can someone our age to work towards that?
That's a good question.
Yeah, I get asked that question a fair amount, and the answer is no. I didn't always want to work for NASA. I didn't wake up one day in grade school thinking I want to be an astronaut or a flight director. It's really something that happened over time. It was largely based on my interest in science and engineering and math. I had some great teachers in grade school and high school that encouraged me. And I hope and know that you guys have those folks encouraging you as well. But I had a great physics teacher, a great calculus teacher in high school. They encouraged me to take advanced placement courses so that I was ahead of the curve before I got to college. And then I just continued on with those studies once I got to college. I honestly thought I would go work for one of the major aircraft manufacturing companies, a Boeing or a Lockheed, when I got out of college. And I was fortunate enough to be on the same floor as somebody that was going to do an internship in college here in Houston as an engineering intern. And we got talking about it one day, and we were friends and in the same classes. And he told me, I was, you know, hey, I'm going to Houston next semester to be an intern at NASA. And that got me interested, and I applied. I figured, what's the worst that can happen? They'll tell me no, you know. So I applied, and I was accepted. So a lesson to you guys is follow your interest and take chances. You know, get out there, and, you know, even though you're maybe a little bit gun-shy or a little bit afraid of the answer that might come back, sometimes you get exactly what you're aiming for, mm-hmm. and sometimes you don't. But that just means you need to try again or try a little harder. Just, again, follow your interest and take chances.
So who's up next?
Hi, my name is Valentina. What college degrees does it take to become an astronaut or work for Mission Control?
To work in mission control, we look for a degree in science, engineering, or mathematics. We have folks that have physics degrees and chemistry degrees, as well as any number of engineering degrees, all Bachelor of Science or higher, master's. To my knowledge, there's only a couple of PhDs running around here in mission control. And the astronaut corps is very much the same. A large number of astronauts come from the United States military, either the Navy or the Air Force or the Marine Corps. They go through officer training, and they typically have at least a master's degree, and that gets them the foundation that allows them to apply as an astronaut. The criteria to become an astronaut are listed out there on the NASA website if you're ever interested in doing that in the future. And the criteria here in Mission Control, again, are very similar to that. So just, again, follow your interest, and if you follow science, engineering, or mathematics, you dramatically increase your chances of coming to work here at NASA.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Gabriel Ramos, and my question is, how does it feel when you're landing on Earth after a mission?
Hi, Gabriel. I personally haven't returned from space. I haven't flown in space. I oversee the safety and success of those missions for my friends, the astronauts and cosmonauts who fly from here in Mission Control. But what I've been told is it really depends on the spacecraft that you're returning in. The space shuttle glides to a slow landing on a runway, and I've been told by some of my astronaut friends that they hardly knew when they touched down, that it was such a soft, smooth landing that you know, they knew they were within the Earth's gravity field, but they didn't know that they were on the ground. And then the Soyuz, the Russian spacecraft that returns cosmonauts and astronauts, is a little more abrupt than that. It has thrusters that fire only in the last few feet before it hits the Earth's surface as it glides down on parachutes, and you slow down from almost 100 miles an hour to nothing in those few feet. So it's a pretty abrupt stop as you get back to Earth, and you really know that you've landed.
It's like a small car crash, but they can take it. They train for it, so they're okay.
Hi, my name is Alex, and how do you stay balanced when you're floating inside space?
How do you maintain balance while you're floating in space?
Yes.
Yeah, the astronauts have a lot of what we call handholds and footholds in the cabin as they're floating weightless in space. And what they'll do is they'll just tuck their foot underneath a strap or a handle, and they'll just hold on to that. You don't need a whole lot of strength to hold on to things in space because you're weightless. So the only thing you need to do is control your momentum and motion in space, because the harder or faster you're moving, the harder it is to slow you down. So they just delicately hold themselves either with a handhold or foothold. So like if you're using a camera, you tuck your foot under a strap, and then you use that to basically brace yourself against the floor, ceiling, or wall, and then you use both your hands. So it's a pretty simple process. I've been told that after a few days of flying, you really get a sense of how to perform that. And it's kind of funny sometimes when you see a brand new astronaut coming up for the first time, they kind of use a little too much force. They're a little too aggressive in how they're maneuvering around or how they grab a handhold, and they look kind of clumsy for a few days. But after a while, they really get the feel of it down, and they do really well.
Yeah.
All right, that's a wonderful answer. I'm going to cut in again. This is Ryan at the DLN. I believe we only have about a minute left with Mission Control, so I may want to allow Josh and or Mike to say any parting words of inspiration before we say goodbye.
You want to wrap it up?
Yeah, I just want to thank you guys for being with us, and again, welcome to Mission Control. You guys are just down the road from us, so please come visit us. We've got the Rocket Park out here in front of NASA, and anybody can come see that. It doesn't cost a dime. You just need to get there during daylight hours, and you can see rockets that have flown in the past. We've got the visitor center here, and if you know somebody here at NASA, you're certainly welcome to come visit us. Maybe I'll see you here in Mission Control someday. But other than that, listen to your teachers, keep studying, make sure that you follow your interest, and take chances when it comes time to apply to a college or find the job. You you never know where that's going to lead. Even though you might not find the ideal job right out of school, it'll provide contacts and friends, and it'll let you know what you're interested in and what you're not interested in, and that's valuable information. You're the only one that knows what's right for you, so make sure you take chances and make those decisions.
Yeah. So thank you guys down there in Galveston. Like Mike said, come see us sometime. We've got some of the coolest jobs in the world, and hopefully one of these days you guys will be here working with us. So thanks to you guys, and thanks to you, Ryan, for letting us talk to the students.
All right, guys, you want to say thank you?
Thanks.
All right. We'll see you later.